Hey team, welcome to today's members webinar. Today we're going to be talking all about brake pressure system data. We're going to get into the nitty gritty of it soon, but first, as always, we'll get into a bit of a pre-show first and show you guys what's been going on around the shop and around the place for us. Over on my laptop screen here, I've got a shot of one of our GD86s, which is an SR powered GD86, which had a recent track outing. It was last weekend. We took it to a really low key local race event, and that was the first time that car's been on track this year, and in a while. It's had a lot of updates over the summer period in preparation for our endurance racing season, which is going to start up here later in the year. You can see there we've got some wet tires sitting next to the car. We actually had some relatively heavy wet running certainly in the first part of the event, but these new Michelin wets we've been running have been fantastic. They always are, and the driver that was driving that car was definitely very impressed with how well they performed on track. It's certainly the quality of a wet tire makes a massive difference. This is a shot of the same of that front of that car, once we got it back to the workshop. So at the moment, we're sort of focusing on trying to get some of the mechanical elements a bit more tidied up. We've had a couple of mechanical problems, and we've really just been refining the original concept of that car, things like improving cooling efficiencies and stuff like that. This is a shot of the car with its new front splitter that will be going onto it at some stage this year. It's just sort of a mock-up, figuring out how we're going to integrate it again with the bumper. And particularly now we've updated a few more cooling things on the front of the car. So at the bottom here, this mesh at the bottom, this is feeding both our front brakes is our front brake cooling. We've got our transmission oil cooler feed here, our engine oil cooler, and then our main intercooler and radiator channel is all fed through this duct here. You can see that we had a different front lip sitting on the front of the car before, but now we're going back and modifying that. We're not going to use that front lip we were using, which has now changed a little bit how we can feed the oil cools at the front. So it's only a little bit of a tweak, but it's not going to be too major. We're also working on next is the air outlets at the side of the bumper here. We've got a few more details to figure out there before we are ready to finalize it. This is another shot of the engine bay after we got back from the track, after it's had a wee wash. This I've talked about before, this area over here, where we put a whole lot of new heat shielding in the engine bay. This actually worked really, really well. It was all the upgrades and all the effort that Jimmy, our fabricator, put into getting that sorted really paid off. It was actually so good that even after running hard on track, the car could come straight in. You could actually hover your hand over one of these heat shields without being burnt, which is a big big change from what we had before. Heat management in any turbocharged setup like this is always massively challenging, but we've made some good gains in that direction as well. So it's been really promising. We have also had the gearbox out of that since that event. We did actually have a couple of, we didn't have any sort of terminal problems with the gearbox. We did have a couple of maintenance issues. There was a noise in there, so we've got that out, giving a bit of a strip down and a check, which is all pretty standard stuff. This has got the brand is TTI. It's a sequential 6-speed dog box. You can see there, it's a relatively compact thing on the bench. It's in the middle of being stripped down and getting a bit of a service. So that's just sort of normal ongoing maintenance for us as well. Yeah, so that's it for about what's been happening around the shop. A lot of that sort of effort in our shop has been going into that car recently. As far as what's been going on our socials, I thought I would just mention that we did have a really, really interesting video go out on the Formula Student competition tyre selection. So this is from an interview I did towards the back end of last year, and it's all about a local Formula Student team talking to one of their technical guys about how they select their tyres. Now, for anyone that doesn't know what Formula Student is, it's essentially a university competition where people build small single-seaters and they go and race them against other universities. It's a really, really big and popular competition. But one of the interesting thing about this competition is that the level of sophistication in the cars is enormous. Certainly much more than you would see even in some sort of lower end professional series. The cars can be particularly trick, and particularly with the tyre selection, there are a lot of options that they've got to choose from. There's a lot of tyre companies that are making specific tyres for the Formula Student competition. Obviously they're packaged, they're very small, you know, they're sort of in the 10 to 13 inch range. There are lots of different funny aspect ratios. The cars are obviously really small and light. They're really specific. They're much bigger than a go-kart tyre, but a lot smaller than sort of a normal single seat or race car tyre. So this is speaking to Jared here. We were talking about how they go through the process of how they integrate things like simulation and track testing testing, for making decisions on how they were choosing tyres, which I actually thought was a really interesting discussion because it is a big and interesting topic. So I definitely suggest you guys head over to our Instagram page and check out that video if you haven't seen it already. On our forums, again, things have been pretty busy on the forums as far as lots of good questions coming through, lots of really good discussions coming through from people. I thought I'd just highlight this question that came up a couple of days ago. It was from one of our members, Matt Cooley, and his question was about using a Panhard rod with his leaf spring suspension. So he's got, from what I understand, an older style car that's got rear wheel drive and has got leaf springs in the rear, and they've got a Panhard rod which is doing the lateral location of the rear axle. And he was just asking about, is a Panhard rod the right way to go? What are the other options out there? What are the downsides and stuff like this? So, and it turned into quite a informative conversation. There were a few members that jumped in and gave their 2 cents worth, which was definitely really valuable as well. But I thought maybe I'd just talk a little bit about what a Panhard rod actually is in case anyone isn't familiar with it. So if we've got our, looking from the rear of the car, so this is our tires, and let's say this is our rear axle here with our diff sitting in the middle. So a Panhard rod, the idea here is that let's say we've got the leaf springs that that Matt's got in his car, so they would look like this from the back with some shackles dropping down. The idea with the leaf springs is they're purely there to look after the vertical component of springing the car, but strictly speaking there's nothing laterally constraining the rear diff. What I mean by that is if you put any side force on the back, while there would be some restriction by the leaf springs, the purpose of the leaf springs isn't to support the diff laterally. We need to do that with something else, and that's really what the Panhard rod is there to do. So the idea behind this is, so let's say for argument's sake this is our chassis up here, just really simplifying it down, a Panhard rod may look something like this. So the idea here is that any side forces, so obviously we've got lateral tire forces coming into the car, they are reacted all through this rod here. That's how they are reacted through the chassis, and that's what locates the rear axle on a lot of older rear wheel drive cars. Now there are some downsides and some compromises with the Panhard rod. It's a lot simpler setup, it's a lot cheaper setup to produce, and I think this is why you see a lot of manufacturers back in the day when live axles were more common are using this, just because it's simply a much simpler setup than one of the other setups that I'll go on to talk about in a second. One of the problems with it is you can see here, because this rod is on an angle, as we move up and down on the rear axle, necessarily this whole rear axle is going to translate from side to side. So because this is on this Panhard rod's on an arc, it means as we move up the axle is going to move to the left, and as we move down the axle is going to move to the right. Now you can negate that a little bit to some extent by choosing the angle of your Panhard rod at ride height, and particularly in the case if you're running a circuit car and you don't have a lot of vertical movement of your tires, then of your whole axle, then you don't actually necessarily get that much angle, that much position change on your rod. So whether it's the length or the angle or the ride height or just the amount of suspension trim you need, that's going to determine whether a Panhard rod is going to be suitable for you or not. So if that's something that's interesting to you guys, I suggest you go and check that out. That was on the Motorsport Wheel Alignment section of the forum, if you guys have got some similar questions to that. The other option which came up in the discussion was the idea of a watch linkage, which is another really common. In fact, in a motorsport context, it's probably much more common to see watch linkages than Panhard rods these days. Certainly, it's something you'll see if you go look at any sort of high-end car with a live axle built back in the day, like something like an old BDA Escort or something like that. They'll all have watch linkages. What that is instead, it's sort of a different take on a Panhard rod. The idea here is if you've got, you might have some, let's say this is the chassis here again, you might have some mount dropping down here and some mount here. The idea here is that you've got a sort of a two-piece Panhard rod, you can kind of think of it, that's got a center pivot in here. And the idea here is that as this moves up and down, this whole link that's pivoting, it's pivoting at this point on the diff here, this rotates round, and these the beauty of it pivoting in the middle like this is that even though the angle of those arms is changing, each one of those watch linkage arms, the position of the diff actually stays central in the car. You don't have any lateral translation as you do. As long as everything's set up properly, you don't have any lateral translation. The really key important point about this for a watch link to work properly is the angle and length of these watch link arms must be equal to each other in order to keep the diff spaced centrally. Yeah, so that's just a little bit of it was a good question that came up. It's not something maybe we get asked too much about because it's a relatively uncommon suspension setup these days. Obviously, most cars are running things like McPherson struts or A-arms or multi-link suspension, so it's not quite as common. So I thought it was a useful discussion to have. So also you guys should know about upcoming courses. So we only really only just released our professional motorsport data analysis course. So that was a follow-up to our data analysis fundamentals course. So if you guys have already taken the data analysis fundamentals course, or even if you haven't, if you are interested in this topic, there's two really great courses now that span a pretty wide range of motorsport data analysis stuff, everything from the complete beginners right through to everything you need to be going and sort of starting your job at a professional level. It's a that new professional data analysis course is definitely well worth checking out. We've also got a race driving fundamentals course, which is currently in production, which is slated for release sometime this quarter. And I'm also working on a new suspension fundamentals course, which will be aimed for being released about halfway through the year. So keep an eye out on the future courses coming out as well, guys. All right, so that's it for the pre-show. I'll be back in a second and we will get straight into the log data analysis for braking systems. If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.